vice chair walking in the door. Now we need an author. We will begin as a subcommittee. We have actually more members coming, so please try and get some of the authors here so we can start. Thanks. Good morning. I'm so pleased that we have an author. Senator Wright, you're on. You're first in the door. Senator Wright, item number two, which is, actually you have a couple bills in front of us today.
Yes.
Item number two, SB 286, which is a redevelopment bill. Would you care to present?
Thank you, Madam Chair, and members. There's been obviously a lot of discussion here recently about redevelopment in California. Redevelopment goes back to 1945 in California. It has probably been the preeminent redevelopment, economic development tool in California in that period of time. Not only does it create jobs, not only does it revitalize neighborhoods, not only does it provide revenue to cities and to the state, in this area it also is probably one of the strongest job creating elements that we have and that we do. There's certainly been some discussion about taking redevelopment away. We'll discuss a little bit later that much of what the governor proposed is unconstitutional. He's been in court twice and lost on some of the things that we've already done. We may end up having to repay some of the money that we've already taken from redevelopment agencies. It will not be the first time that we've raided funds only to have to pay them back. In my time in the legislature, I think this will be the third or fourth time we've had to do that. What SB 286 does is it reforms a number of the things that people had concerns with about redevelopment. One of the things that has occurred with redevelopment was the issue of bypass, that being local school finance. This bill will end the ability to, on a prospective basis, it will end the ability for local school money to go into the redevelopment agency. SB 286 stops that. It does it prospectively. What that means is that in time, as the existing redevelopment agencies begin to wind down, that you'll create a system where soon there will be absolutely no bypass whatsoever. But going forward, none of the redevelopment agencies will have any bypass element that they work from. One of the concerns that people raised was that you had blight. And blight became a definition that was amorphous. This tightens up the definition of blight. We wanted to limit the total acreage of land that was included. We wanted to strengthen the reporting accountability. There are a number of other things that it does, but I think, you know, in some instances, a picture is worth a thousand words. We presented to you a series of pictures of what redevelopment agencies have done. Whether you're in Bakersfield or Burbank or Contra Costa County, you see the effect of what redevelopment agencies have done. There is nothing else that is available that will accomplish this goal in the way that redevelopment agencies have done since 1945 in California. With me today are John Shirey, a representative from the League of California Cities. John is the executive director of the agency. He is who I worked on the bill with. Let me say as well, there are a couple of other changes if we're able to advance the bill today. I want to be clear that there are a couple of changes, particularly the issue of sports facilities. That will not be in what ultimately becomes the final draft of the bill.
All right. Thank you. In support, your witnesses.
Thank you. And good morning, Madam Chair and member of the committee. My name is John Shirey. I'm the executive director of the California Redevelopment Association. I want to take just a few minutes as the sponsor of the bill to give you some sort of general perspective in terms of what's here. First of all, this legislation is designed to do a number of things, not the least of which is to provide more accountability, really more oversight, and also more measurement, quantitative measurement of the achievements of redevelopment agencies. But it also responds to a lot of complaints that we've heard from legislators who have said to us, I don't want to vote to end redevelopment, but it's got to operate differently in the future. And the senator has explained some of those features which make it operate differently in the future. It's designed to reduce the footprint of redevelopment, and that's one of the complaints we hear. You're too big. You know, it's too big. It's grown too much in a way. It's been too successful, and this will reduce the future footprint of redevelopment by taking away about half of the tax increment from new project areas and so on. It's also, though, perhaps more importantly, designed to focus redevelopment on those policy objectives which we think we share with the state of California. Those policy objectives being things like job creation, cleaning up brownfields, transit-oriented development, affordable housing, all of those things which this body collectively has said, these are things that we need to address in California. This legislation focuses those local efforts in those priority areas. Lastly, I just want to, two more things I just want to point out, that when you take this bill along with SB 450, which was passed by Senator DeSaunier's committee and voted on by three members of this committee, we will have the most comprehensive reform of redevelopment since 1993 when AB 1290 was passed and carried by Phil Eisenberg. So this is a significant package from the standpoint of reforming redevelopment. I want to thank and recognize the efforts of Senator Wright, but I also want you to know he pushed us. He pushed us and said, you got to go further, you got to go further. And we kept coming up with more issues and more provisions, including taking out the school share. You know, that's his contribution. He made us do more, and I think that's a good thing. Lastly, I just want to say that there's a design in this bill also, hopefully, to give us some hope. Hope that we could put to rest some of the, frankly, rancor between state officials and local officials over this issue of redevelopment. I think we all have a common purpose. We all want to see California grow. We want more prosperity. This is designed to do this, and I'd like to see us working together to make that happen. So thank you very much for your consideration.
Okay. Are you a sponsor as well?
Yes. Dan Kerrig, on behalf of the League of California Cities, I want to echo the comments of Mr. Shirey in terms of the content of the bill. There's a lot, from the city perspective, there's a lot of bitter medicine in this bill. I mean, we've always guarded our redevelopment authority jealously. This is a critical tool for our urban core areas. We've got cities have 83% of the state's population. We're being looked to, especially in, as we move forward. From a state policy standpoint, that our urban core areas are expected to handle more and more of the state's population. That's going to take a lot of retrofitting of our existing infrastructure and upgrading our existing communities if we're not going to sprawl. We need redevelopment as a tool. As we've gone through this year, and we've certainly listened to the concerns of legislators that are friends of redevelopment, they've said, you've got to tighten up this process. So. This bill does tighten up redevelopment significantly. It puts in a lot more accountability measures. And our board of directors supported this bill unanimously on Monday. So we've heard the message, and we're responding to the concerns that have been raised because we need this tool as a resource for California's challenges going forward. So we appreciate your support.
All right. Further witnesses in support, and I ask you to be extremely brief because we have a very long agenda.
Very brief, Madam Chair. Jason Gonzalez, representing 50 cities throughout the state. While many of them do not have official positions on this legislation, they are very appreciative of Senator Wright and the members of this committee's interest in protecting redevelopment because they absolutely have a position on the governor's proposal. Although I do understand the governor has suspended the construction of Death Row, so hopefully we won't be heading there, and we respectfully ask for your support. Thank you.
David Jones, on behalf of the city of Pasadena, also in support. We think this is a very significant package. We'd ask for an aye vote.
Support.
Johan Klaes, representing the city of Livermore. They're in support. They think these are meaningful reforms that clamp down on some of the abuses of the past. Thank you.
Thank you. In support.
Thank you, Madam Chair, committee members. Alex Esparza on behalf of Mayor Villaraigosa and the city of Los Angeles here in support. We appreciate the leadership of Senator Wright and Senator Huff as well on this issue. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members. Roxanne Miller, City of San Jose, representing our mayor today, Mayor Chuck Reed, in strong support of this legislation. Allow us to do the necessary reform so we can create jobs, move the economy forward, and housing. Thank you very much.
And support.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Tony Rice on behalf of the cities of Covina and San Gabriel in strong support.
Thank you. Thank
and
you. Support.
Hi, Helen Bean, Director of Economic Development and Housing for the City of Emeryville. We're in support of this bill. It focuses redevelopment on the essential tasks of creating jobs and promoting sustainable development through brownfields remediation and infill development and funding basic infrastructure.
Thank you very much. In support.
Bill Osagai for the City of Compton. We're still analyzing the legislation, but we expect to be in support.
Thank you. Further support? Opposition. Please come forward. Welcome.
Madam Chair, members of the committee, Christy Baumer representing the California Professional Firefighters. Respectfully, we are opposed to this bill. We have had the honor and pleasure of engaging in lively debates with the author's office about the benefits and pitfalls of redevelopment project areas, and most directly to fire districts. They are 100% a pitfall. For example, in Los Angeles County, they lose double-digit millions of dollars annually to the various redevelopment project areas in their jurisdiction. They are 100% property tax funded. You freeze their base. They don't have options of TOT, sales tax, or any of the other revenue-raising opportunities that other local governments have, and they have absolutely no say in the process. And so, while respectfully, we believe these agencies have sort of run amok since Prop 13 eliminated local government's ability to adjust their own property tax rates. They have become the next greatest place where you can incur debt, even to your own general fund, and they never, ever repay it without voter approval. and I think the numbers are rather sketchy about whether the job creation is real or if they just steal them from other communities. And so while I appreciate the fact that for this 1970s, some Prop 13, I'll do the math, you know, almost 40 years, redevelopment project areas have resisted and successfully defeated almost every step of reform until they faced elimination. So we will continue to support the governor's proposal and oppose this measure and hope that the legislature in its wisdom, as I know many authors are working on, some other way of really, truly working on affordable housing and economic development tools for cities. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. In opposition.
Opposition, Karen Klinger, private individual who is an agent broker for 40 years. I highly oppose Senate Bill 286, and this just gives more power to cities and counties with their general plan updates, regional land use planning associations, to continue to steal and divert more money away from neighborhoods and services like fire, police. Education may be protected, but those of us will end up paying the tax. I'm sick and tired. It's time to abolish the very thugs that steal and take private property without protection from this legislature. Those people, small businesses, the people who end up paying the tab are the ones in the middle who never get the entitlements, get subsidies, and this has to be abolished. Redevelopment can no longer exist. It's time to turn those property tax increments back to the people for services. Free enterprise is being stolen and taken. Every day, redevelopment agencies continue. They are replacing the real estate industry and continue to control every parts of our life through managing growth, managing transportation, managing every phase of how we live. California will no longer be able to live and strive. This must be abolished and their $94 billion debt paid. Thank you.
Further witnesses in opposition? All right, hearing none, I would first like to just make a couple comments. My recommendation to the committee is that we hold this bill in committee, not the least of the region. The reason is that, on Monday we received 8 pages of amendments to 17 sections of the bill. The bill is significant. It is it is complex, and the expertise for analyzing redevelopment is in this committee, and I would like to see it held. We all understand that there may be an alternative to the governor's proposal, and this well may be it, and that doesn't prevent you from holding it in committee, doesn't prevent you from continuing to work on that and to be engaged in those ultimate discussions that will be occurring over the next 6 weeks. I have a couple questions. There are some parts of this bill that are excellent and do indeed reform redevelopment. And either you, Senator Wright, or you, John Shirey, whichever one of you wants to answer some of these questions, there are some major reforms of redevelopment agencies that I don't believe are included. And let me ask you the questions. Senator Wright and I have talked often, and our caucus has had many discussions about the diversion of property tax from the schools, which the state general fund reimburses, and that is the issue going forward. And Senator Wright has been clear wanting to change that situation. So my question to you is, in the current bill, I haven't looked at the amendments, in the current bill, does the bill allow for the establishment of new redevelopment areas and issuance of new debt without voter approval?
Yes.
Number two, does it allow for the bill, the taking of property taxes from special districts, continuing without their approval?
Yes.
And taking private property by eminent domain?
Yes, it doesn't change eminent domain laws.
All right, thank you. For those reasons, that is the fundamental changes. Those are some of the fundamental changes that really have to be considered with respect to redevelopment. And considering the schools issue, which is paramount and which Senator Wright and I have talked often about as being the paramount issue, that needs to be very clear in the bill and is not. My recommendation to the committee will be to hold it, again, recognizing that there are very good changes in here with respect to transparency and accountability. So now it's open to the committee for any kind of questions or suggestions. Senator Huff.
Yes, Mr. Shirey, was it your board that voted on this, or have you polled your cities?
Yes, our board.
And that is part of the struggle that I have here. I think it became apparent when redevelopment agencies were in the bullseye of the governor's budget that we all came together, and at least agencies in every city I have except for two has an agency. They wanted to keep it from getting killed. How we reconstructed it, we've been working on. As you know, we've worked in a collaborative manner to try to come to that. Many of these reforms Senator Wright and I have worked with. But I don't have feedback from my cities on it, and so, you know, that's something I would like to get a comfort level with. While the chair and I have gone down different paths, I think we have the same conclusion that it would be better to deal with this in the context of whatever happens with redevelopment, and that may very well include most, if not all, of these items. But I would like to just make a comment on some of these comments are made in opposition. Clearly, they want to kill redevelopment. I do not. I think it actually does serve a very useful purpose. The pictures you handed out exemplify what happens. The assumption by some of the people speaking against it is that absent redevelopment, you would have the same amount of money flowing to education or public safety, and that's just not so. Because, as you know, you have blighted areas. They're not developing the potential. Therefore, they're not developing the tax. And so that baseline is still going through to those agencies as you have developed something that lifts all boats and eventually does flow back to those other agencies. But to say that it steals and diverts more money from fire and police, I think, is a blatant misstatement. In fact, in my district, the fire and police tend to like redevelopment because they are getting more facilities. They're getting some things that they can't normally get if it was just left in a non-developed state. And there's a lot more I could say on it, but I just want to clarify that while we arrived at the same conclusion, it's definitely a different thought process, different motivation. I appreciate Senator Wright's work on this, as well as everybody else has been working in a collaborative way to improve redevelopment, to tighten up some of the offenses. And I might also say that briefly that even when we did the reforms back in the early 90s, a lot of those are still playing out, so people still believe that is the slate upon which we are writing. It is not. As a city that tried to define blight and could not and became part of the court test case, you know, of what blight wasn't, it is a lot more difficult to set up blight than it is now. There's a lot more issues in there, but because of the long life of this, people look at redevelopment as if it hasn't changed, and yet it has. And so, anyway, I'm not going to be supporting this today, nor will I be voting against it. I'm just not going to vote on it. But I would like to see it become a two-year bill so we can work on this. But probably a better approach is to see this in the context of the overall agreement that we negotiate.
Would you like to close, Senator?
A little. I appreciate the discussion. I would say something, you know, again, with respect to the fire stations, redevelopment has built a number of fire stations in cities. So it's almost laughable when somebody says that you're stealing both fire stations and police stations. There was a discussion about the money that goes forward. Most of the redevelopment agencies forward much of the special district money in. So that argument that the special districts are not taken care of is kind of bogus. But, you know, I mean, we, you know, in this building, it's nobody, you know, doesn't like a little hyperbole. There have been significant amendments to redevelopment over the years. When redevelopment started in 45, it was about predominantly changing the industrial and business climate. I worked with Congresswoman Waters then in the Assembly back in the 80s when we added a housing element. That didn't exist in redevelopment before. That was an important addition because housing did become an important element of making it work. I thought, you know, in the post-Prop 98 era, that it was important that you recognize that the bypass wasn't created as a problem by redevelopment agencies. It was created by a subsequent Proposition 98 that said that you had to backfill the school. That wasn't the fault of the redevelopment agency. Prop 98 changed several things, the ability to adjust taxes, and it created the backfill issue in Prop 13 and 98 together. That was not the fault of redevelopment agencies. The concern I have is that as we look at this going forward, the reforms here, I think, are important. I would hope that we would not get into a circumstance where you had a county-by-county vote on whether or not you had a redevelopment, because I can tell you that in a city like, and because, you know, my information suggests that you have to have a vote in a county, because the county tax is affected when you do one. So if I were to go, for example, to Los Angeles, if Compton wanted to do a redevelopment agency, they'd play hell getting the people in Beverly Hills to vote aye for it. If you had a redevelopment agency proposal in Diamond Bar, you'd play hell getting the people in San Bernardino to vote for it. And because it becomes a county function, you would have to have a countywide vote on that issue. So if we make it a thing where you have a vote, essentially, that's another way of killing it, because that just says you'll never get one. Are there other ways you could finance them? Sure there are. If you look at different ways. The problem is that they all cost far too much money, and you just wouldn't be able to make it work. I mean, we've obviously, there's been some abuse in eminent domain. We've already begun in other bills, and this one doesn't address it specifically, but it narrows down the use of eminent domain, and that's been done by redevelopment agencies across California. So I hope, again, if it doesn't move, it doesn't move, and we'll kind of sort of keep doing what we've been doing. I think that this is substantially better than the status quo. It doesn't prevent, and we did not include in this, the issues of finance. One of the other things that I think that's important is that going forward, one of the concerns raised was whether or not you had enough money from the redevelopment agencies to backfill some of the things that we want to do. There's a proposal, we took it out of this so that it would be a part of the budget, that would do that. And additionally, Senator Lowenthal has a bill that does reforms on the housing element. I think if we take this and the housing element and ultimately settle on how much we claw back from the redevelopment agencies to go into this budget year, not next year, but this one, I think that this becomes a good compromise. You know, if it is the will of the committee that we hold it, then, I mean, committees do what they do. I think this is ready to go today. I'd like to, I mean, if I don't get a vote, then that's okay. I mean, I don't take it personally. I mean, I've learned around here, if I got mad at all the things I lost, I'd never have any things I won. I think it's ready to go. I think it makes sense, and I don't think that it gets much better. I mean, most of the people who have problems with this bill typically do not like redevelopment, period. And you know what? I can't help them. I think, and I'll close here, this has been the most fundamental redevelopment, job, economic development tool that the state of California has ever created. Nothing even comes close. Nothing is even in the same realm in terms of delivering jobs, redevelopment, and prosperity to many of the cities. Nothing comes close. This is it. This reforms that in a way that I think is as positive as we're going to get.
Thank you, Senator Wright. As I said, the recommendation is to hold this in committee. I think, again, this issue is on the point, and the discussions that will be taking place over the next 6 weeks, certainly you'll be a part of those. And the amendments that were brought to the committee should be analyzed and looked at and worked on with the stakeholder group that you have convened for this issue. So with that, we have a second bill that is on the agenda, that is SB 830, but I'm going to take a moment to, we have a quorum. Please call the roll.
Volk?
Yeah, do. Here.
Volk here? Huff?
Five, no? One, two, three, four, five, yes.
Huff? Here. Up here. DeSaunier? Fuller? Hancock, Hernandez,
here.
Hernandez here, Kehoe,
here.
Kehoe here, LaMalfa,
here.
LaMalfa here, Lou.
We do have a quorum. All right, thank you, Senator Wright. Let's move on to your next bill, which is SB 830. This is an income tax credit for infrastructure investment. Please present your bill.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members. SB 830 picks up on an attempt out of the state of Louisiana as a means of financing improvements in ports. The state assumes absolutely no risk here. And let me say that again. The state assumes absolutely no risk. The state only has an upside. What the state provides in SB 830 is an agreement to look at a project going forward, but the developer of the project has to complete it all and demonstrate that there's a financial advantage to the state. So the state assumes no risk. The state only has to stand by and let the project be built. Why do I have a concern for this project? I represent the Port of Los Angeles. The Port of Los Angeles at one point in its time was one of the largest container facilities, Los Angeles and Long Beach together, in the world. It provided, in California, we provide some 500,000 jobs that come from ports. If I take Los Angeles, Long Beach, Oakland combined. The difficulty that we have, Madam Chair, is that over the years, we've not kept pace with the rest of the world. Cargo does not have to come to Los Angeles. It does not have to come to Long Beach. And if I take the port, for example, in Los Angeles and Long Beach, literally there are jobs created in San Bernardino, Riverside. In Oakland, the port creates jobs that extend back to this area. There are jobs that are created in Stockton through ports as we ship goods and services out. The difficulty is that we risk losing that. Prince Rupert Island is looking at taking much of what we have in port business. Seattle has already taken all of the BMW cars that used to come into Los Angeles. In 2014, the Panama Canal will be expanded. When they expand the Panama Canal, the largest shipping company in the world, Maersk, has already moved from San Pedro to Galveston, Texas. So what we're looking at, Madam Chair, is whether or not we want to invest in protecting a financial infrastructure that now employs over a 500,000 people in the state of California. SB 830 provides doing that with absolutely no risk. The developer has to build the project, has to demonstrate that the financial viability had taken place, and then the legislature can decide on its own that the financing worked out, and then it issues the subsequent tax credit. That's what the bill does. The state assumes no risk, there's no downside, there's only upside, and if it's concluded that there was no financial advantage, which people raise as a cost about tax credits, then you don't do it. Failure to do this, again, as I'm looking at whether it's Maersk moving, I'm looking at ships coming out of the Panama Canal, by 2014, absent this kind of effort, there will probably be a reduction of somewhere in the neighborhood of 35% to 40% of our container traffic. Container traffic is measured in what are called TEUs. 35% to 40% would be another 300,000 to 400,000 jobs that we risk losing. That job will come from whether it's San Bernardino, where there's a container transit place. We have cargo that comes out of LA, goes on a train to San Bernardino, Riverside. Trucks travel in, pick it up, take it back. It is an enormous business and profit center for the state of California. We risk losing that because we've not made the significant improvements to our port over the last 20 years. The day when people say, I have to come to Los Angeles, I have to come to Long Beach, those days are gone. So whether or not it's Savannah, Gulfport, Mississippi, Savannah, Georgia, Newport News, Virginia, you can look at the map that you have. Everyone else is preparing that we will not be able to take care of our business in California. Those states and cities are betting against us. And the only way that we have to demonstrate that we're prepared to hold on to what we have left of that industry is to begin upgrading our ports, and this provides that.
Senator Wright, thank you. Witnesses in support?
Yeah. Thank you, Madam Chair, members. Mike Jacob, I'm with the Pacific Merchant Shipping Association. We represent ocean carriers and marine terminal operators. And principally, we're in the business of making direct investments in ports and operating those terminals. And we operate in all 11 public ports. And the Senator referred to the map in front of you. It underscores the competitiveness in the industry and what we expect to be happening in the next couple of years, which only builds on the competitiveness impacts that we've seen that were pre-recession. In 2007, of the world's 50 largest container ports, only two in the entire world were not growing. Those were the ports of LA and the ports of Oakland. We have some serious hurdles to doing business here in a competitive way. And it's just the cost of doing business, and for good or for ill, that is what it is. And symptomatic of that, the average lease term and construction financing term in our ports has gone from 15 to 20 years to the latest concession at the Port of Oakland was actually financed over a 50-year period. And that's a concession that includes very substantial upfront private investment. And as Senator said, we're not looking for anything upfront. What we're asking for is a pathway to partnering with the state. We think there's a lot of value just in enacting this bill, even if there is no follow-up allocation, even if the legislature says in a future year, we think what you're doing is business as usual, and we don't think it deserves an allocation of money to finance the credit. We still think that that's a significant step towards establishing a pathway to partnership, because as Senator Wright pointed out in the documents you have show, we don't know what's going to happen in 2014 and beyond. Panama Canal is one thing. That same year, we also have a coastwise labor agreement with ILWU come up, which creates uncertainty regardless of the outcome of that. We have a credit facility for the Alameda Corridor in Los Angeles of nearly $800 million, which balloons that year. We have very, very significant cost issues, in addition to the fact that 2014 is the year where the cold ironing regs come on with about a $1.5 billion price tag to ocean carriers for calling California as a California-only expense. So we have a lot of things we're trying to deal with. And what we'd like to do is put in place a program with no upfront cost to the state, where at some point in time in the future, we can come back to you and say, here are the competitive pressures we're under. We've already established the mechanism for the legislature to help us compete. Can we get to that point where we're ready to make a decision together to move forward? And if at that point in time we don't make our case to you, that's fine. But this bill puts in place the ability for us to make that case and bring that to your attention and ask you for the assistance we need to make ourselves as competitive as possible. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. In support.
Madam Chair and members, Tim Schott on behalf of the California Association of Port Authorities, which is comprised of the 11 commercial publicly owned ports here in California. We would emphasize the new global marketplace that we are competing in. I think you've heard a lot of it already, but it is a very different place. We have very significant infrastructure needs, and we have some $5 billion in California-only investments that are required to meet our environmental goals. Much of that is regulatory, but a whole lot of it is also incentive programs and activities that the ports themselves have undertaken to go significantly above and beyond what is regulatorily required. This bill has the potential to let the marketplace know that California is open for business. We want your business. And it is not just something that might benefit the larger ports of Oakland, Los Angeles, and Long Beach, but it has real potential to benefit our smaller but critical niche ports that serve important marketplaces, such as the ports of Sacramento and Stockton, San Diego, Redwood City, San Francisco. So we think it's an important discussion to have, and that it has some real potential to help send a signal that we want this business that is looking at other alternatives. I would remind members that the ports largely, not all of them, but most of them sit on state tidelands, manage those properties in trust for all of Californians. And it's a critical component of the property of the state tidelands and what we do. Thank you.
All right. I would ask you to be very brief, please.
Thomas Vu with the California Chamber of Commerce in support.
Thank you. Further support for this bill? Opposition, please come forward.
Lenny Goldberg, California Tax Reform Association. We don't disagree with anything that has been said about the importance of ports, importance of the infrastructure, and the need to invest in it. And I've had conversations with Mr. Jacobs about that over the years. What we question is the convoluted nature of the financing that's contained in this bill, which is effectively an open-ended tax credit, except that the legislature would have to allocate the money, except that the local government would, or the local port would say, these are the benefits that we have, and ask for that allocation. There's got to be more efficient ways of doing that. With regard to tax credits, we often say, put the money up, get the money out the door, know what you're buying with it, and invest in the ports and in the infrastructure. Alternatively, we have had amounts of money that have been capped and allocated, including some that aren't being used right now, such as the employer tax credit, which was we put $400 million in and hasn't been used. And those capped and allocated credits, depending on how they're done, can work more directly. So we think, you know, our problem here is using a tax credit in a somewhat convoluted system. I'm not sure it benefits the infrastructure investment. I'm not sure the state is making, whether or not we're making an open-ended commitment rather than a very targeted program.
Okay. Further opposition? All right, hearing none, are there questions from the committee? Senator LaMalfa.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. The bill has its ups and downs in there, certainly, but I do like the idea that you can cause there to be an incentive for port infrastructure. A couple things I'm curious about are, for somebody that did work that would be seen as eligible for the credit, say in 2011, 2012, but the authorizing legislation that is required later doesn't happen until, say, 2018, when the state is flush with money again, just as an example. Will they be able to draw down this credit at a much later date? Is it any time during this 10-year period that we're looking at that, you may do the work, you may be eligible for it right now, but can they draw up on that later if the legislature in later years decides to go ahead and authorize via the second piece of legislation?
Right. Yeah, that's a good question, especially given the novel nature of the credit we're proposing. What we would expect was that when you bring in an application, you would be saying, here's the total amount of money I can take in any 1 year as a credit, and then whenever the legislature authorizes that, that's when it would functionally occur. So if you didn't do it until 2018, you could still take that 1 year, but you wouldn't be able to do it until 2018.
So you'd have to carry this on your books. You'd have to develop your business plan as if you're never going to get the credit until the legislature authorizes it.
That's exactly right.
And have a survivability plan if it never does, but nonetheless hope that maybe it'll happen sometime in the future.
That's exactly right.
But at the end of 2020, the whole thought sunsets and you're...
And the total liability to the state is limited exclusively to the amount that's actually allocated in the budget at any one point in time.
Mm-hmm.
So even if you have multiple projects that have amounts outstanding and the total amount allocated is less than the amount outstanding to be claimed, then pardon me, then that amount would be prorated over all the projects that are outstanding for that year.
That would have to be specific in that later legislation. It would be prorated percentage-wise over the project, or do you think you would fill 100% the first one, first served, first?
Well, it's in the
until you run out.
Yeah, it's in the bill. The way it is drafted is that regardless of what amount is allocated, if it's anything less than, it's prorated across all of the credits that are eligible to be funded that one
year. So the percentage, very good. All right. One of your points here, you have only projects which increase selected freight project parameters would qualify. Is there a little more specificity on what those selected freight parameters might be?
Yeah, thank you. We adopted the same parameters that were included in Proposition 1B, which was the transportation bond, which funded infrastructure projects for ports and air quality improvements for ports. And those basic principles have come down to, is there an evaluation of increased throughput, velocity, or reliability of cargo? And that's something that we require upfront in the economic impact studies that are done by the ports that are then forwarded to the FTB.
Maybe it doesn't matter what the type of cargo is, it's just more that there's a volume that it increases above what...
Right. Yes, it's not limited to containerized cargo. It can be bulk, it can be break bulk. The idea is to make the cargo, when the legislature and if the legislature ever says, we believe that you need this to be competitive, that those would eventually go to the shipper. They would go to the bottom line of the operation, and those get passed through.
Very good. Thank you.
Further questions from the committee? Yes. Senator Kehoe.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And more comments than questions, but Senator Wright, I think this is big picture and creative, as you like to say, also very complicated. And there's just that one little question about how much it would cost. But I think that there is some very important issues here that you're bringing up. You know, the key cost question, which we can't answer yet, you know, is it's a bad time to be having that discussion when we're already dealing with such a huge deficit. But I think you're right on point about how California remains globally competitive with shipping, how our West Coast ports can continue to thrive after the expansion of the Panama Canal, which I don't think the legislature has really looked at what that might do to our California ports. And it's imminent in you know, business planning terms. I think this should be the topic for a special hearing, and something that we could look at, maybe come down to Los Angeles and have a hearing at the port and look at what's going to change or what's likely to change as a result of Panama Canal expansion and other factors that, you know, I don't even know about. I mean, I know we're going to do that. I looked over the map. Thank you very much. Good map. And I think, although there's a lot of information on here, some of it's, you know, it's not all apples to apples. You've got the Port of New Jersey in New York investing $600 million in improved infrastructure, but you don't mention the Alameda Corridor on our side. So, yeah, I think we should kind of look at, and it's a little while ago, but still it was a big, big improvement. And so I would like to get more information on, you know,
15 years.
Where are we in the race? You know, what can we do with technology and infrastructure investment to keep us competitive? And how will that be changed by business decisions around the Panama Canal expansion? So we have a goods movement and a port select committee. Mm-hmm. And I would suggest to the chair in this committee that maybe there could be some kind of a hearing in the fall that looks at these issues in detail and brings in, experts to tell us what's up. But Senator Wright, I really applaud you for putting all this together and thinking about, how we get this conversation started. I'm not sure I'm into a 50% tax credit, right now, but I think that is one of a number of things we could look at for incentives, maybe a smaller amount. But thank you for bringing it forward.
Senator, thank you for those comments. I would like to make a few along the same line, and I think the idea of a select committee hearing that focuses the attention, worthwhile, important attention, on the issue that you brought forward ought to happen. But there are two reasons why, if there is a motion for this bill, why I can't vote for it today. The first, and you took the bill off agenda last time to work on some of these issues, and you did make some, the measure allows for the tax credit to pay for CEQA mitigation, and case was made certainly to do that in discussions, and you've narrowed the bill, and I appreciate that, but you have not eliminated that use of general taxpayer dollars, incentives for CEQA mitigation compliance, and I just don't think that's appropriate. Secondly, it's an extremely creative way of approaching tax incentives, and given the kind of economy we have and the kinds of demands we have, I applaud you for doing that, for thinking outside the box. I hate that expression, but that's essentially because it's been used 100 times. But the fact is, this is creative and innovative. But I, too, think, along with Senator Kehoe, that a tax credit for me is an incentive. It's not a reward for a project after it's been built, especially at the 50% level. But the notion that there is a pay it forward, essentially, that there's a commitment by the legislature over time for certain kinds of incentives is a good one, and I think that ought to be pursued. But in this particular case, you know, I think that that's an awful lot of money at this time, and a mechanism that really needs to be looked at more thoroughly. So my recommendation to the committee, if there is a motion, would be no, or to abstain. All right, the bill's been moved. Would you like to close, Senator?
I appreciate the discussion. When I first took office in the Senate, there's a community right near the Port of LA called Wilmington. It's actually a part of the city of Los Angeles. And the port workers and the longshoremen at that time had an annual event at Christmas where they used to provide food baskets and toys to the families in Wilmington. For the last 2 years, the families in Wilmington have been providing that same benefit to the longshoremen and port workers. We will soon have the greenest port in the world. It just will have no jobs in it if we're not careful. While we're deciding what we do, the world isn't waiting. So yes, we did do an Alameda corridor, and it started almost 15 years ago. It's been underutilized because the demand for cargo coming into the port has dropped. We measure cargo, Madam Chair, members, in what are called TEUs, or 20-foot equivalents. We've seen the TEU throughput in Los Angeles and Long Beach drop. So yes, Merck's just left. In Oakland, you saw one of the major shippers there move to Arizona. I said, boy, is this guy clairvoyant, or does he believe there's going to be some, you know, oceanfront property in Phoenix and sometime soon? But he just found that it was cheaper to leave here and go there. This bill poses no risk. The legislature has the opportunity to say, we don't advance the money. They have an opportunity to look at the deal. One of the things that has always been challenged about tax credits is whether or not the tax credit really occurred and whether or not it was done according to some specification. Here you get that, because if it's not done, then you don't advance a dime. So there's absolutely no risk. You can also look and see whether or not the state made money. So what you'd be giving back as a tax credit is a portion of what you took in. Again, Billy Preston, a singer from my neighborhood, had a song that said, nothing from nothing leaves nothing. Currently, that's what you got, nothing. And if you take nothing from nothing, you'll have nothing. Here you have an opportunity to see investment in your port. The money that gets invested is going to come from private sources. So people are prepared to risk their capital, and all they're asking for is the potential to get a reward at the end of the rainbow. Should we have a CEQA thing? Absolutely, we disagree, Madam Chair. If we impose a standard that no one else does, then that becomes an impediment to that person making an investment. If he chooses to invest in spite of that, then I think that we should look at least making attempt to make him whole. We would give him money for the permits and fees that he would invest. We would give him money for the federal requirements that we would do. We would give him money for all of the other things. How do we select that we're not going to let him get credit for what was a part of what was in the law anyway? We created the law, we created the cost, and then we say, but that cost you don't get a credit for. Keep in mind, again, that he's only going to get a portion back. So, again, I appreciate the discussion. But, again, question from Senator Kehoe, how much is this going to cost? You know what? Maybe nothing. Because if they don't put up their money and demonstrate that there was profit to the state, then there is no risk. So here you have an opportunity to get investment with no risk. There's no front-end cost. That's all you get. And here we're looking at other people are saying, we're going to bet that California's stupid. So as whether it's New Jersey or Virginia or Georgia or Mississippi or Texas or Louisiana, if we keep doing what we're doing, we'll keep getting what we've been getting. So, I mean, the committee will obviously do what it does, but I submit to you that the world isn't going to wait to figure out what we do. The Canadians have done that. I live in Southern California. I remember when every BMW that came into California and every BMW that came into the Western United States came into the port of Long Beach. Not anymore. I can remember when most of the cargo that came in that was going to over two-thirds of the country came into the port of LA and Long Beach. Not anymore. So we can keep doing what we're doing, and we can just watch it dwindle away.
Thank you, Senator. There is a motion. please call the roll.
Volk?
No.
Volk, no. Huff?
Aye.
Huff, aye. DeSaunier? Fuller? Hancock? Hernandez?
Aye.
Hernandez, aye. Kehoe?
No.
Kehoe, no. LaMalfa? Liu?
You have two votes. The roll remains open until the end of the committee.
Thank you very much for the hearings, ma'am.
All right, thank you. Have the two authors decided between themselves? All right. Welcome, Senator Simonian. SB, you have two items, SB 34 and SB 506.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I know that you have a long agenda, and I know that our pro tem is waiting to join you, so I will be very brief indeed. On Senate Bill 34, as amended by committee, simply imposes an unspecified fee on water use imposed at the retail level to provide a sustainable revenue source to fund the public benefits of water-related projects and programs. The broad category of public benefits to be funded includes enhancement of public trust resources, protection of public health and safety, and physical improvements to existing conveyance and supply infrastructure. I think members of the committee know that, according to the LAO and the Public Policy Institute of California, we've got an unfunded need for funding in this area ranging as high as $100 billion. Some of it's capital, which could be and appropriately covered by general obligation bonds. Much of it, however, is programmatic. And while I am a supporter of the water bond, want to say that clearly, I don't think we can count on that moving forward on the current schedule and at the current amount. So this bill simply proposes that a state account and regional investment accounts be established, half the funds kept at the state level to be used for projects of statewide or interregional significance, half distributed to regional accounts on a pro rata basis. The bill was amended in Senate Natural Resources along with your bill, Madam Chair, Senate Bill 571, which would determine how the regions are determined and how the regional projects are compiled based on a model somewhat similar to the STIP model used in transportation planning. Clearly, this is a there are no dollar amounts in the bill. This is a vehicle for further discussion. Should note that it goes to appropriations. Should also note that a two-thirds vote is required. At some point, we're going to have to come together and say to ourselves, so all that conversation we had in 2009, how do we now pay for it? That's really what I'm attempting to do here, is make sure that conversation takes place, and I would respectfully ask for an aye vote.
All right. Witnesses in support, please come forward. Witnesses in opposition, please come forward. Okay, I'm going to urge you to be brief and succinct. We have a 10:30 order of business. Yes. Welcome. Welcome.
Thank you, Chair Woke. Cindy Tech with the Association of California Water Agencies. Aqua strongly opposes this bill, and I want to raise three issues very briefly. First is the obvious issue of whether this is the right time to put in a new assessment or tax on the retailers. We suggest it is not. And we note that many of the details in this bill have not been worked out. The analysis notes the blanks on and lists some of them on page 4. There haven't been any meetings with stakeholders, and we think this bill needs a lot of work. The second issue has to do with the beneficiary pays principle. The bill references that principle, but in our view, it doesn't implement it appropriately. The concept is that the, when you're talking about infrastructure financing, as this bill is proposing, is that beneficiary of the program action should, to the extent they directly benefit, they should pay for the program costs. And Aqua agrees with that principle if it's implemented appropriately. But under SB 34, some of the investments would provide public benefits, and we think that those should be paid from by state and federal sources, not by assessments on retailers. The third issue that I wanted to raise is that the bill is, in addition to having these flaws, it's simply premature. The legislature passed the water bond, as you know very well, in 2009. It was passed by a two-thirds vote of the legislature. It goes to the voters in 2012. New state policy on water infrastructure financing should take into consideration the result on the bond. And so we think this measure is premature.
Thank you.
Okay. In opposition.
Yes. Jennifer West, on behalf of the California Municipal Utilities Association, we are opposed to SB 34, which would impose an annual fee or tax on every agricultural and urban retail water agency in the state. We actually think this might interfere with local agencies' ability to provide reliable and clean water supply. Local water providers are now raising their own funds for needed water infrastructures that are important to the voters in their community. So CMUA is now surveying its members, but we already know that a great many local agencies have gone through the Prop 218 requirements and have raised their own fees to pay for these needed infrastructure requirements. We're seeing this more and more to fulfill the requirements additionally to 7X, which passed in 2009, which specifically required retail water agencies to meet a 20% water conservation goal. So by assessing a state-imposed fee on ratepayers, SB 34 would restrict the ability of local agencies to assess a fee that might be necessary to provide infrastructure for their own district and to comply with state law. And as Cindy pointed out, and as the analysis state, at this point the bill is all about blanks and answered questions. SB 34 would create this complicated process where 50% of the funds collected from an individual retail water agency would then go into an unspecified number of state-managed regional accounts. And then individual agencies would have to apply for the regional funding. But as the analysis states, there's no method for managing or administering the funds at this point, which is a major omission in our view. It does say the legislature would then have to appropriate the funds. So we believe that this would ultimately become politicized, get tied up in the budget process, and at the end of the day, local water agencies may not only see a fraction of the funds that they sent to the state for this purpose. So in closing, CMUA thinks that local agencies are the best prepared to make these local funding decisions. And we urge you to hold the bill in committee today.
All right, and I would like ID only, please.
Madam Chair, members, David Jones, on behalf of Burbank Water and Power, we agree with the comments made by the associations. We think the crowding out and the blanks in the bill would ask you to hold the bill in committee, because until those policies worked out, we think it should remain with you. Thank you.
In opposition.
Thank you. Brief. Jason Ryan, California Outdoor Heritage Alliance. We're particularly concerned with the fees and how they will impact wetland conservation in the state of California. Additionally, we have programs within the Department of Fish and Game that provide incentives for landowners to flood up their properties. This will undermine that practice. We oppose the bill.
Okay. Identification only, please.
Gail Delahant, Western Growers. I'm representing Farm Bureau also today. We oppose the bill and ask you to keep it in committee.
Thank you.
Kathy Mannion, Regional Council of Rural Counties, also here in opposition. Thank you.
Carolyn Jensen, KP Public Affairs, on behalf of Mojave Water Agency, Western Municipal Water District, and Westlands Water District, in opposition.
Gina Rodriguez, California Taxpayers Association, opposed.
Christian Foy, on behalf of Three Valleys Municipal Water District, in opposition.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members. Glenn Farrell, the Fryant Water Authority, we're opposed.
Madam Chair, members, Kendra Dijogo with the Gualco Group on behalf of the California Council for Environmental and Economic Balance, Kings River Conservation District, Kings River Water Association, Kern County Water Agency, Modesto Irrigation District, San Bernardino Valley Municipal Water District, Solano County Water Agency, and the Upper San Gabriel Valley Municipal Water District, all urging you to hold this bill in committee. Thank you.
Okay. Further opposition? All right, questions from the committee? Senator Huff.
Yeah. Frame these more as comments than questions, and to the degree that you wish to address them, and I know that's normally your manner, Senator Simidian, you can do that.
Not so much when the pro tem's standing behind me waiting to speak.
Yeah,
so
there
Senator
you go.
Huff, so.
Standing, tapping his foot. I do have a comment. You know, the committee analysis refers to it as a fee or assessment, and yet the ledge council says the bill would result in taxpayer paying a higher tax. And maybe you can address this, but why in the world would we want, not now, but later, but why would we want to tax something as basic as water, which we all need? It's the sustenance of life, when we don't even tax food. That would be one. And we're also, the governor in the budget has, and we've been seeing through this committee, a whole realignment process from the state to the local level on things that have sort of gotten imbalanced over the year, and we're struggling with how to do that. But this bill seems to go in the opposite direction, and we're once again going to the local ratepayers, asking for some money from them that goes into the state fund without any guarantee that they're going to get something back to benefit their agency or their region.
I'm very concerned about the farmland tax. We have put a lot of obstacles on farmland. I think that those cheaper crops to grow that do take a lot of water will be fallowed. More importantly, for many farmers, they don't have the huge capital necessary for investment in the higher risk, higher profit. You know, it will put some of those guys out of business, and we will have fallowed land, which I'm not sure that as the number one ag state in the nation is something we really want to go to. I believe it conflicts with the 2009 water package, where the legislature put into that agreement state general fund, because there is a public purpose throughout the state. Probably the most difficult thing I have is a result of our budget process in the last couple of years, wherein we have taken funds just like this that are assessed for a particular purpose, and in our infinite wisdom, we have found another purpose for them. And I submit to you the off-road vehicle fund just this year, you know, that we're sweeping a lot of money. There's other illustrations of the same thing, but in that case, you actually had an industry that agreed on it, bipartisan support, and yet we're taking it to you know, balance the general fund and not providing the service for which it was collected. So I'm not going to support your bill. Those are many reasons why, but I guess that one question perhaps you could incorporate at a minimum on your close is, why would we want to tax water? Thank you.
All right, further questions from the committee? All right, Senator, would you like to address these issues?
Thank you, Madam Chair and members. Members, I think if the history of the state over the last 25 or 50 years tells us anything, it's that denial has not served as well as a policy on water in California. The observation was made by one of the witnesses in opposition that the local agencies are dealing with this. If so, it's curious to note that the Legislative Analyst's Office says there's more than $100 billion in accrued infrastructure investment need. Clearly, the work is not being done at the local level, and that's not a critique of the folks at the local level who are struggling mightily. It's an observation about the need for action at the statewide level. Brief observation, there's clearly, given the testimony, plenty of work to be done with stakeholders, but I did want to indicate we had a representative from Aqua who expressed concern about that in particular. Tim Quinn, the director of Aqua, sat in my office and had a conversation with me about the bill, so I just didn't want people to walk out of the room thinking that that hadn't been the case. I want to go to the fundamental question that Senator Huff raised, because I think it is I think it's a good way to frame the debate here, which is, are we going to continue to let folks do their own thing without a coordinated statewide policy to pay for this, or are we going to start the conversation now about what is the level of need going forward and how are we going to fund it? And, you know, the answer to the question from Senator Huff, I think, is best characterized by a conversation I had with one of my constituents whose teenage daughter recently asked her for a hefty increase in her allowance. And she said, well, honey, why do you need an increase in your allowance? And her daughter said, well, Mom, stuff costs money. And, you know, and that's the answer. Stuff costs money. If we don't want to do the stuff, then we don't need to fund it. But if we acknowledge that for what Senator Huff and I at least do agree on is an essential of business and daily life here in California, if we're going to have that, if we're going to provide that, then we've got to figure out how to fund it. That is a debate that remains to be had. That's why there are not dollar amounts in the bill, because I think reasonable people can and will disagree about what the proper allocation ought to be. But I think the conversation needs to move forward. I think what I'd like to suggest is I'd like to ask that the committee do move the bill forward to the Appropriations Committee, but we'll park it there while we have these further conversations with stakeholders, which do need to be had. But simply saying let's hope for the best with the bond is not a strategy, I think we do need a strategy on a statewide basis, and I would respectfully ask for an aye vote.
I will entertain a motion. There's a motion to pass to appropriations, and I'd just like to make a couple comments as someone who's working with Senator Simonian on the structure of future water investment in California. This is a conversation that's long overdue. It's not just about 2009. It's about how we fund the $1 billion of infrastructure that we need in the state of California, and that has a great deal to do with beyond the Delta, although that's important. So I think it's really important to move these conversations forward, and I wish you good luck.
Thank you.
Do pass to appropriations. Please call the roll.
Wolk?
Aye.
Wolk, aye. Huff?
Yes. Huffno, DeSaunier, Fuller, Hancock, Hernandez.
No.
Hernandez, no. Kehoe.
Aye.
Kehoe, aye. LaMalfa.
No.
LaMalfa, no. Liu.
You have two votes. We have more members of the committee who will be coming, and at the end, the roll will remain open until the end of the committee.
Thank you.
Do you want to move on to the next bill?
I do, because I can assure the chair and the pro tem that this is much quicker
there is
and easier.
There is support on both sides. It is item number 5, SB 506. Senator Simidian, do pass as amended to appropriates is
Thank
the recommendation.
You. I have witnesses who are here only to answer technical questions if they exist. This is first and foremost, I should say, I take as author's amendments, recommended amendment to address the issue of Administrative Procedures Act raised in the analysis. This measure simply updates current law that allows the recipient of a registered warrant to use the warrant to offset or pay an existing tax liability. Reflects current and common practices where bonds are held in electronic form. Came out of the GO committee with a 12-0 vote, no opposition. Respectfully ask for an aye vote, and let me ask my witnesses just to introduce themselves and indicate that they're available for questions if they exist.
Witnesses in support.
Margaret Gladstein on behalf of Apple, and
Jason Lungard with Apple.
Okay, further support. Identification only, please.
Mike Ropes on behalf of Qualcomm in support.
Robert Callahan, Tech America, here in support.
And Jim Hawley at TechNet, also in support. Thank you.
Opposition, witnesses? Seeing none, questions from the committee? Motion from the committee? It's been moved from Senator Huff. Please call the roll. Do pass as amended to appropriations.
Wolk.
Aye.
Wolk, aye. Huff.
Aye.
Huff, aye. DeSaunier. Fuller. Hancock. Hernandez. Kehoe. Kehoe, aye. LaMalfa.
Aye.
LaMalfa, aye. Liu.
You have four votes. Roll will remain open. As Senator Steinberg is approaching the desk, let's do the consent calendar. Could I have a motion on the consent calendar, items 15 and 16, both committee bills? It's been moved. Please call the roll.
Wolk.
Aye.
Wolk, aye. Huff. Huff, aye. DeSaunier. Fuller.
Consent.
Hancock.
Consent.
Hernandez.
Aye.
Hernandez, aye. Kehoe?
Aye.
Kehoe, aye. LaMalfa?
Aye.
LaMalfa, aye. Liu?
That has five votes, enough to pass. We will leave the roll open. Yes. Senator Steinberg, welcome. Item number 9, which is SB 653. Welcome.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair and members of the committee. If I may make a brief opening statement. I appreciate your consideration today of Senate Bill 653. This was a measure, as you know, that would considerably expand the taxing authority of counties and school districts, subject to the constitutional voter approval limits imposed by our Constitution, specifically Proposition 218. The authority would extend to the personal income tax, the sales and use tax, the vehicle license fee and excise taxes, including but not limited to an oil severance tax, a local alcohol tax, a local cigarette and tobacco tax, a local soda tax, and a local medical marijuana tax. The bill itself would not raise local taxes by one penny. It would, however, give local officials greater flexibility in shaping tax proposals to place before voters, and it would leave the ultimate decision of raising revenues with the voters, who are the source of the ultimate political power in our democracy. Madam Chair, in presenting this measure, it is more than defensible as tax policy consistent with the notion of realignment, bringing services closer to the people. But I am primarily motivated here this morning by one objective. The state and its people cannot afford to cut public education $5 billion, nor public safety by a comparable amount. The current fiscal situation, with less than 2 months before the start of the next fiscal year, has left schools, police departments, sheriff's departments, and other public agencies contemplating not just the possibility, but the reality of pink slips for over 20,000 teachers and massive reductions to education and to public safety. We cannot leave schools, its teachers, children. We cannot leave our communities with just one uncertain option when it comes to closing the 2011-12 budget and putting this fiscal crisis behind us. I don't have to tell you, any member of this committee or any member of the public, that this is serious business. And while you will hear opposition and concern from our partners in the business community about the challenges of granting local control to school districts and counties, I ask the following question. Are these challenges or problems greater than the impact of class sizes of 40, children without qualified teachers, the elimination of sports and extracurricular activities, or the virtual elimination of parole services for release state prisoners? That's the balance that I ask this committee and ultimately the legislature to weigh. There are a couple of policy concerns raised in the committee analysis that I would like to address up front. The analysis reflects the fact that some of the opposition letters claim that this bill could lead to a balkanization of public services because not all communities will choose to exercise their new taxing authority in the same way. Of course, the whole point of the bill is, in the absence of adequate state funding, to give communities a choice, not to dictate what that choice would be. And something, imperfect as it may be, is better than what we may be left with without the state revenue to be able to fund public education, higher education, and public safety. This bill would certainly not alter any state funding formula or make any community worse off than it is today. Schools already have local taxing authority, and expanding that authority should not, in and of itself, raise equalization issues that don't already exist. I know that there is going to be a significant amount of testimony. I recognize controversy inherent in this measure, but I want to say that, in conclusion, I think it's good public policy. Beyond that, like you, Madam Chair, and like I hope all of us in this legislature, I have one laser-like focus, and that is to make sure we do everything possible to avoid unacceptable cuts to schools and to public safety. I urge an aye vote.
Thank you. Witnesses in support.
Supervisor Provenza.
Jim Provenza, Yolo County Board of Supervisors. We support the bill. This legislation would give our local voters expanded choice in terms of taxing options and whether or not to pay for vital services. The two-thirds requirement for special tax and the majority requirement for a general measure would remain. In Yolo County, which I don't think is unique from other counties, we are faced with an inability to continue to provide basic services. We are at the lowest level of employees per 1,000 residents at any time within the last 20 years. We have cut deputy sheriffs. We have cut public health nurses who go into the homes of at-risk pregnant women. We are threatened in our ability even to handle the increased caseload of food stamp recipients who come to us in the recession. Although that's not our money that's going out, we're the ones responsible for processing the applications and doing outreach to make sure that everyone gets those federal and state benefits that they're entitled to. This particular measure would grant much greater flexibility in terms of analyzing what tax might be appropriate in particular communities and allow the counties, cities, and school districts to place measures on the ballot. In particular, public safety is very much threatened. It's the largest area of discretionary spending in counties. As county supervisors, we're tasked with protecting public safety as well as delivering social services. When we are to the point we're at where we've cut year after year after year and there's just nothing left, that's what goes next. And if you saw the article in the Sacramento Bee about the cuts, proposed cuts in sheriff patrols in downtown Sacramento, you realize that it really is a threat to everybody's safety. And I worry that with basic services going, in particular public safety services, we start to look more like a third world country than the state of California that I grew up. And this just allows us to go to the voters and say, would you like to pay to keep your sheriff patrols? Would you like to pay to keep your public health nurses? Very much favor this measure. Now, getting a tax measure passed will never be easy, and all these taxes aren't going to pass. We're lucky to get one of them passed, but the increased flexibility will allow us to go to the voters with something that has the chance of passing to finance the schools and finance public safety.
All right, thank you. And witnesses in support, why don't you start?
Good morning. I'm Deborah Brown with the California School Boards Association. We're obviously in very strong support, as we very much support the ability for school boards to have greater options to raise revenues locally. Senator Steinberg noted that there was that districts are facing $5 billion in cuts next year under the LAO's proposal. But what was also not mentioned is the $18 billion in programmatic cuts and deferrals that districts have incurred in the last few years. And when you look at the cumulative effect of that, while costs have risen significantly, we're looking at at least 30,000 teacher layoffs, I think 10 to 20,000 layoffs for classified employees. We're looking at furlough days, so non-work days. School districts are cutting schools by 5 days. That's 5 days of lost instructional time for kids. And we're facing significant reductions in services and support, fundamental things like after-school care for kids, library services, computer services. And this bill would allow communities to invest in those programs that they deem valuable. If the state legislature is not going to support increased revenues that will help fund those programs, and they're not going to provide stable, adequate, and sufficient funding for districts, then at least allow districts the option to raise the revenues locally. Let communities decide what they want to invest in, and they will invest in their schools. Give them that option. We urge your support.
Okay. In support.
Senator Wolk and members, Jean Hurst on behalf of the California State Association of Counties, also here in support today. I think Supervisor Provenza summarized it well. This is about local options, an ability for counties that they do not currently have to ask the voters what kind of community services they want in their communities. I will give my quick broken record speech about realignment. We are in a period of great uncertainty, obviously, given the current state of affairs with the budget, but we believe that this is an important tool in addition to sort of a fundamental restructuring of how we govern and provide services at the local level and how we fund those services. So we would urge your support, and we'll continue to work through the process with the senator as well.
In support.
Madam Chair, members, Sarah Flocks on behalf of the California Labor Federation. I echo the other speakers before me. We represent the firefighters, the public safety officers, the public health nurses, and the teachers who are on the front line of providing services who face losing their jobs or reduced resources to do their jobs. And we support giving local voters and local government the tools they need to protect basic services. Thank you.
In support.
I'm Stephen Rhodes. I represent Los Angeles Unified, Santa Ana, and San Bernardino. While they haven't taken a formal position, they have always been supportive of this concept, and they are. I've sent them the information. I would also like to add, I was also the chief witness on the Serrano case for the Western Center of Law and Poverty, and I've worked with the author on numerous issues concerning disadvantaged kids, and he's always committed, and we will work, and if there are problems, we'll resolve those issues. Thank you.
Thank you. In support.
Terry Anderson on behalf of Torrance Unified School District. We're in support.
Thank you. Support.
Lynn Falks on behalf of the California Federation of Teachers. We're in support. Obviously, the $18 billion in cuts that schools have sustained over the last few years have made it very difficult. We believe this measure will allow for self-determination for local areas as to how they want to fund their schools and what level of programs they'd like to offer. We ask your vote.
In support.
Jennifer Richard on behalf of the California Center for Public Health Advocacy in strong support, especially the provisions related to the establishment of a local excise tax on soda.
Okay, in support.
Okay, Haley Cortless on behalf of the California Tax Reform Association, and we are in support.
All right. Further witnesses in support. All right, can I see witnesses in opposition? Have you chosen speakers?
We think we have.
Okay, good. And who are your speakers?
Myself and Ann.
Okay, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. Members, Gina Rodriguez with the California Taxpayers Association. I'm also here representing a coalition of more than 50 companies and associations. We certainly appreciate Senator Steinberg's efforts to try and resolve the state's financial crisis. However, granting blanket authority to counties and school districts to ask their voters to raise taxes is certainly not the answer. We need to get the state's house in order, not support the creation of potentially more than 1,000 new taxing jurisdictions. SB 653 represents a major shift of power from state to local government, a shift that would have major implications for the state's long-term economic recovery, as well as local economic growth. Legislators should be responsible for what the state looks like as a whole. Granting taxing authority, and therefore fiscal responsibility, to counties and school districts would in effect create a fragmented system of taxation, county against county, school district against school district. Senator Steinberg mentioned balkanization, and we believe the bill would create barriers for disadvantaged communities and thus raises constitutional concerns. Here is a quote from the first Serrano decision in 1971. Obviously, a richer district is favored when it can provide the same education quality for its children with less tax effort. The poorer districts are financially unable to raise their taxes high enough to match the educational offerings of wealthier districts. Thus, affluent districts can have their cake and eat it too. They can provide a high-quality education for their children while paying lower taxes. Poor districts, by contrast, have no cake at all. With respect to local excise tax authority, the bill would create a structure of taxation that obstructs opportunity for low- and middle-income taxpayers. We have a 1965 report we found done by the California Assembly that concluded that excise taxes are an extremely inequitable, and I'm quoting, if not the most inequitable type of taxation that bears most heavily upon the lower income groups. Excise taxes take proportionally more of their income and as a consequence reduce their ability to purchase other needed commodities. With respect to the local personal income tax authority that this bill grants, when coterminous governmental units impose a personal income tax, taxpayers would be subject to a layering process, so potentially four different layers of personal income taxation. And I actually ran some numbers through my tax preparation software. I have that example if anyone would like to know what the hard numbers are. There are numerous administrative concerns that both the FTB and the Board of Equalization have pointed out in their analyses. There are also significant compliance costs for taxpayers under this bill. If the administration and compliance costs are excessive, then it scarcely matters how attractive other aspects of these taxes may be. For these reasons, we respectfully oppose the bill. Thank you.
Thank you. In opposition?
Excuse me. I'm Captain Ann Kinner, owner of Seabreeze Books and Charts and a member of the National Federation of Independent Business. Seabreeze has been providing navigation materials and official publications to the maritime community from our store in San Diego for 30 years. I am a professional mariner. I'm concerned for the maritime safety, and I do not want to be at the helm if Seabreeze goes down. Since the start of the recession in mid-2008, our sales have fallen by almost 30%. I cut my own salary in half in order to keep two employees. I have no leeway in pricing even while my expenses go up. San Diego County and School District can certainly be expected to ask for these taxes if this bill passes instead of looking for real efficiencies of operation. Increased taxes mean reduced sales for me and for everyone else. My customers are running out of money. I am running out of money. More taxes will make the situation even worse. Business is leaving California because of our tax burden. Please do not pass this bill. Thank you.
Witnesses in opposition.
Yes, Chair Wilk, Senators. My name is Eric Sklar. I'm the owner and founder of Alpha Omega Winery, a member of the Napa Valley Vintners, and I also served for 8 years as a city council member in St. Helena, most recently as vice mayor. As you can imagine, I'm well aware of the budget challenges facing cities and counties, having worked on that for the last 10 years as a council member. But this bill is not the answer. Counties and cities and school boards already have enough taxing capability to solve the problem if that's where it should be solved. But this bill would create an uneven tax structure, further pitting city against city, as we see all the time in Sacramento, the basketball team, as an example. We can't have cities fighting for each other for taxes. This really needs to be solved here in Sacramento. In answer to Senator, to President Steinberg's question, of course, we all want to protect those things. And our industry is willing to see higher taxes in a number of ways, but doing it in this way at the cities is really not the way to solve it. We are very supportive of all those things. The answer is, of course, we want to protect the schools. We want to protect our public safety for our community and for our children. And I think that, like most Californians, we're not opposed to taxes to solve this budget problem. We want to see it solved. So we ask you to reject this bill as not the best way to solve it. We're all in this together as Californians, so let's solve it here in Sacramento where it makes the most sense. The Vintner community is ready to roll up our sleeves and help you with solving the problem.
All right. I would ask you to be brief.
Madam Chair, members, John Latimer on behalf of the California Retailers Association. I will be brief and try not to repeat the prior statements.
Thank you.
We are opposed to the bill, obviously very concerned about the potential of a patchwork of additional tax rates on a whole variety of products that we sell. We, like the previous speaker, our industry is very supportive of all of the services, and the school system is important to us, law enforcement is important to us, local government is important to us. They're our partners in every way. Which is why the California Retailers Association supported the tax package that was part of the budget deal several years ago and supported the extension of it when it was on the ballot 2 years ago. We do think that the solution needs to be a global solution, not a patchwork, if you will, of varying tax rates. Very hard to implement from our end, and frankly, again, we think it creates punitive pressures on various products that, again, ironically for this committee, could lead to a new debate about the fiscalization of land use and the importance and attractiveness. I know you recently had a bill on this about big box stores and all the value that they may bring or may not bring to a community. You know, now all of a sudden, if all the various number of the various products that they sell have greatly enhanced value, it's going to also exacerbate the situation. I know you, the chair and the author, otherwise aren't in favor of. So we would much rather see a statewide approach to this. We've been on board with that process in the past, and we'll continue to be and look to work with the committee on a broad-based solution.
All right. Sir.
Yes, Madam Chair, committee members. My name is Charles McIntyre. I'm president of the West Coast Protective League. It's a coalition that's made up of the glass industry and other factories, manufacturing factories here in California. This bill will have a direct impact on these union and high-skilled jobs. We all, you know, want to fix this budget issue. Get these kids into school, but I don't think the answer is putting a lot of these kids as parents out of work that are making good salaries, good benefits, retirement, and the whole thing. We have an industry that is just now starting to recover from this bad economy. We lost a lot of jobs in this industry already, where these companies are just starting to turn around, they're just starting to hire folks back, and they're getting ready to grow again, and this is just going to knock us right back where we're going to have more job losses in this bad economy. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm going to ask for ID only. You're it.
Dennis Loper, California Beer and Beverage Distributors and California Distributors Association.
One sentence.
We have one issue. We are the taxpayer in this issue, and it's going to be a logistic nightmare. I would tell you that in 1967, League of Cities supported a bill to do away with local taxes on tobacco specifically for that reason.
Thank you. In opposition. Identification only, please. Just tell me who you are.
California Black Chamber of Commerce, representing 65,000 members, chamber affiliates, and small businesses across the state.
In opposition.
In opposition.
Okay, thank you. Are you next? All right.
Chris McKaylee, Madam Chair, on behalf of the California Grocers Association, for the similar reasons stated, we are opposed.
Thank you. In opposition.
Karen Klinger, private property owner, small business owner. I oppose this for many reasons, and this is why the governor's proposal to abolish all of the state redevelopment agencies should be eliminated. You need to support the governor's proposal.
Thank you very much. In opposition?
Blair Knox, California Independent Petroleum Association, in opposition.
Opposition.
Madam Chair, members, Ralph Simone representing the California New Car Dealers Association, in opposition.
Okay. In opposition?
Madam Chair, members of the committee, Greg Hines representing the California Manufacturers and Technology Association, would echo many of the comments made in opposition and also state ours. Thanks.
Okay. Opposite.
Bob Ackerman on behalf of the California Nevada Softdrink Association, in opposition.
Okay.
Jason Lane with the California Bankers Association, also opposed.
Okay. Jennifer Barrera with the California Chamber of Commerce, and we are opposed given the lack of certainty and consistency this will create for businesses in the state. Thank you.
Madam Chair, members, Bernie Orozco on behalf of the California Cable and Telecommunications Association, opposed.
Okay. You know, we could use one of the mics. It might be easier. Yes, Ms. Wolf.
Madam Chair, members, David Wolf here with the Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association, representing over 200,000 individual taxpayers from across the state, 20% of which are registered Democrats. Ask for your opposed. Thank you.
Thank you. In opposition? One sentence.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Ron Kingston, representing the San Francisco Association of Realtors, opposed.
Madam Chair and members, Paul DeAero, representing Western States Petroleum Association, and in opposition.
In opposition.
Robert Callahan with Tech America here in opposition.
Opposition.
Madam Chair, Terry Flanagan with the Wine and Spirit Wholesalers Association of California, in opposition.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, Stacey Dwelly on behalf of Family Winemakers of California, in opposition.
Yes, sir.
Mike Velasco, Wine Institute, we also oppose.
Madam Chair, John Gamper, California Farm Bureau, opposed.
Opposed. Further opposition?
Gavin McHugh on behalf of the Distilled Spirits Council, we oppose.
Okay, anyone else? All right, are there questions or comments from the committee before I return to the author? Yes, Senator Huff.
Senator.
Got a problem with this bill?
Yeah, this is, what did she say?
One of the best bills I've seen. With the bill. Go on.
News flash.
For the author, how do we treat taxpayers who live in different counties or school districts?
How do we treat, I'm not sure I understand the question, Senator Huff.
In terms of income tax, if they're, there's so many moving parts of this thing, it's hard to even craft a question.
We would have to, on the income tax, obviously verify the residence of the taxpayer. We can do that through all the records that are already public.
My understanding is the Franchise Tax Board does not keep track of counties where they're coming from. They have more of a state perspective.
I think we would have to work with the Franchise Tax Board to, you know, update their data system to be able to correlate income with residents. I don't think that's an impossible task.
Okay, is a Franchise Tax Board or BOE here to answer questions?
I believe they are.
Could
they usually
I have
are.
Both of them
we have a representative from FTB? Senator Huff has some questions for you.
Okay.
Where's BOE? Coming forward?
Yeah.
Okay.
Forward.
Come on down.
This is a whole paradigm shift, so I'd like each of you to comment on or discuss the difficulties that you would see in the costs or administration of implementing this bill.
Yes, I'm Brian Putler, Franchise Tax Board. So this is a bill that we're only starting to look at. We have identified various issues. One of the issues is what you, Senator Huff, just noted, is the issue of how would we be able to locate or determine whether a taxpayer lives in a particular school district or a particular county. That's just not something at this point the computer system is designed to do. And it means that we would have to undertake to figure out how to implement the law or the bill should it become the law. So I don't think it's insurmountable, but it's just something that the system can't do at this point.
What about the cost?
And that, again, that is something that we will have to develop. At this point, we don't have a cost figure
for it. So you have a clue.
Well, we know that it would be a significant undertaking.
Okay.
John Abbott, Board of Equalization, and we have similar comments to the Franchise Tax Board. It's doable, but there would be costs involved, especially in fixed startup costs.
Okay.
I appreciate your comments. I think it was the Caltax person that was talking about something about auditing. Could I bring her back up, Madam Chairman, just for a quick answer on that? Could you explain in a little more detail what your concerns were related to auditing residents?
Sure. Because the a personal income tax would be based on a taxpayer's residency, we have concerns about getting through the process of the fact that FTB and BB could actually identify where the residence is. But we have concerns about, for example, if a taxpayer was a part-year resident of a county, if a taxpayer, I have a friend who lives in Fullerton part-time. She's the dean of the tax school. She also lives in San Francisco part-time. If both of those counties imposed personal income taxes, which county would she pay? With respect to residency, you know, residency audits are one of the most intrusive types of audits that FTB performs. Brian Putler can probably confirm this. Very fact intensive. Would this bill allow the counties and school districts to perform residency audits? It's not crystal clear, and we certainly wouldn't want to go in that direction. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it did. Thank you very much, and I appreciate that. Having dual residences myself is sort of necessitated by this job. Let me just make a few other comments. You know, currently schools can raise taxes on parcel tax. It's two-thirds threshold, and over 50% of them, I believe the statistics are successful. When they make their case how they're going to use it, the people agree, they do it, it's done. If they don't make their case, well, it doesn't happen. There's a higher threshold of passing for bonds, obviously, at the 55% level. Counties can already do a general purpose tax at the 50% threshold. Probably in some, you made the comment early on that you don't want to cut public safety or schools by $5 billion or whatever the amount was.
More than that, actually, when you add up the remaining deficit.
And being on the budget committee and having been on the road and hearing things up here, I know that's how we're trying to frame the discussion right now, is we either vote for these taxes that we've talked about extending or we have these massive cuts. But that's how you have framed this. That's not how it has to be framed. Those are not the only choices. Senator Leno, in February, sent a letter to the legislative analyst asking what would an all-cuts budget look like. But that wasn't just how it was. There was also some caveats that put the parameters on how the question would be answered. Similarly, Republican leader Conway in the Assembly asked a similar question with some different parameters and got different answers. How you frame the question, what you're postulating, is going to dictate what the answer is. So if you're framing it as, are you going to eat Wheaties or Cheerios, then those are the only two options. But we live in a more complicated world than that. And so if your intent is not to do these cuts, I would ask you to partner with me to find a way to contract out a lot of the state services that, by the way, are contributing to some of these top-heavy pensions. It is estimated that we could save $3 billion if we contracted out what we currently do with state employees. I came from a contract city. We contracted out public safety. We contracted out building inspection. We contracted out park service. We did things in a way that when our labor need went down, we had a contract that we could terminate. We didn't have to keep carrying those people. And many of them had union contracts separately within that, so it wasn't like it was union versus non-union. It was just a business model that allowed us to live more within our means and respond to cycles in the economy. You have postulated here a whole plethora of taxes, and we're already one of the highest tax states in the nation. And it's my belief, and many of those testifying against this, that it is that high tax structure, in addition to the regulations, that is keeping businesses from expanding or locating here. And when they don't expand or locate here, they're not hiring people, they're not paying taxes themselves, the non-existent employees are not paying taxes, or having that whole trickle-down effect. And so this is actually, in my estimation, going absolutely the opposite direction of where we ought to be going as a state. We may not like the Texas model. I know I get people irritated every time I bring it up, but they have 8% unemployment. We have 12%. They have a budget issue also, but they're also faced over a two-year budget cycle, and they had a $9 billion rainy day fund to help ameliorate that. But they've been creating jobs, and we have not. We've been bleeding jobs. So I just think this is going the opposite direction. It seems as a part of the scare tactics we're trying to use to the voters that says we can only choose this or that. It's much more comprehensive than that. I think it's time that we as a state find a way to use the money we have more resourcefully. We find a way to incentivize jobs, creating wealth that pays taxes, rather than just saying, hey, let's tax these guys up here on the high end even more, or let's give all this authority at the local level that will, in the end, create such a lopsided, and we use the word balkanized, but puzzle piece approach to taxation that nobody knows what the heck's going on. So I certainly appreciate the desire to have revenue to fund government. I think we are philosophically opposed at how we get there. We would be through incentives and lower taxes. You've outlined a path of higher taxes, or at least making it easier at the local level to raise taxes, which would result in higher taxes. And I'm reminded of a study in Harvard that was done by a couple of economists a couple of years ago that said in situations where you're trying to come out of a recession, it was their research underscored that a cuts budget versus a tax budget was more likely to get you there quicker than just by raising taxes. And that's not a California state-funded UC Berkeley study. That's an independent Harvard study, and I would bank on that more than I would one that might be beholden to the people that pay the bills for the research. So those are my comments. I'm sorry and predictably cannot support your bill today.
Senator Hancock.
Yeah, thank you very much, Madam Chair. And thank you, Senator Steinberg. This is such an important bill and such an important discussion for us to be having as a community in California right now as we face the erosion of the great public systems that built a society in which we all did so well just a short time ago. I would like to move the bill, Madam Chair, but I would like to say that to the opposition, I heard many of your comments, and I appreciate your concerns. I also appreciate that many of you did try very hard to see if we could not allow the voters to decide whether they wanted to maintain their existing taxes for another 5 years, or whether they wanted to put us in the situation that we find ourselves today. I know that as businesses, many of you appreciate what government does in terms of educating our workforce, providing roads and bridges, and the other underpinnings of a strong economy, not to mention financial regulations so people feel secure in investing their money in our state. You failed. All of us failed. We do not have the ability to do that now. And I actually think it opens up some great opportunities for looking at the size of our state, the unwieldiness of our state, for looking at a return to local control, which really was sharply curtailed after Proposition 13. It led to massive centralization in California, which I think you can say, as you look at our standing on national statistics, has not served the state well. So I welcome a return to the ability of local people who care about the local places where they live to define the conditions under which they will live. I think this is good public policy and allows us to each in our own place, our own region, to pursue our vision of what constitutes a good society. I know that there are many statistics that counter some of the statistics given by Senator Huff, our own Public Policy Institute of California, and others about jobs and one thing and another. But this will certainly be a discussion that we'll have as the bill moves forward, as I hope it will. I think it will be worked on in many of its details, but it is such an important and profound discussion and shift, I think, in a positive direction for the state right now. So I will be voting for it today and hope that it will move forward.
All right. Further comments from the committee? Thank you, Senator Hancock, for your motion. Senator LaMalfa?
Thank you. I was just thinking we could actually label this the Make the Local Government Officials as Unpopular as the Legislature Act.
But governing's a tough thing, Senator LaMalfa.
Yeah.
Got to make choices.
Single digits.
And have it both ways.
I just really had one question. How do you intend that this will stay outside of Prop 26 coverage here with a simple majority instead of a two-thirds vote, since it does indeed alter tax policy in California?
Well, it's very consistent with actually the more comprehensive proposition, Proposition 218. It still requires a two-thirds vote, for example, to raise funds for schools with any of these new sources of funding. Two-thirds of the people. School board can't do it, can't jam it down with a majority vote. It's two-thirds. Two-thirds. Consistent with Prop 13, consistent with Prop 218.
But specifically to this bill to move through the legislature,
it is a majority vote to give. I'm sorry. The question, sir?
I'm sorry. It was just that this should, we would see this as being a 27 vote requirement here in the Senate.
The bill does not impose a tax.
But it changes tax policy.
It allows authority to, at the same rules as currently exist, to go to the local governments. We've done that for sales taxes.
I would expect with Prop 26 it might cause some big legal challenges as we move along. So
we're very confident that it's a majority vote measure, and we'll proceed in that way.
Okay, we do have a motion. Before I go to you for a close, I wanted to
quickly.
Senator Cahill, go ahead.
Okay.
No, go ahead.
Sorry, I just I want to support the bill too, and I think it's very important because this is my 11th year here, and I think some of my classmates are sitting with me. We've had a real struggle trying to come to terms with statewide revenues. We've been unable to, except in some rare instances, and the locals, communities, cities, counties, school districts, law enforcement are suffering because of it. So if we can't do it up here, then at least let's give them the tools to do it at home. And if this helps with that, I'm all on board. This bill deals, Senator Steinberg, you're dealing with the California we're living in today and trying to give the local lawmakers some additional tools to deliver revenues to services people want. We know Californians want the money for schools. They do not want to see class size expanded anymore. The parents don't want to see a longer school year. So I think that you're being reasonable. I think we've talked a lot about the fractured nature of this. Counties, districts can do different things. You know, you're dealing with the real world. It's not the simplest way to do it, but it's a way to get the programs funded. And just as a comment, we had some revenue issues on the ballot in San Diego last fall. Both of them failed. But as far as poor communities being less served by this, and it maybe that will be the reality. The poorer communities, the more economically and racially diverse communities voted for both revenue measures at far greater numbers. In fact, they would have passed if it was only those communities voting. Those folks want to see better services and are ready to pitch in. So I'm happy to support the bill.
I just wanted to make a few comments before I turn to Senator Steinberg for his closing. With respect to tax policy in California, we tend to think that the way it is now, it has always been and therefore should always be. And that's not the case. And you can go, before Prop 13, local governments had, as Senator Hancock said, had much more control over their fiscal reality than they do now. And that's something that Prop 13, in its changing that relationship dramatically, centralizing, as Senator Hancock said, a lot of the not only fiscal but the authority in the state, really took the basic control away from people over their own lives and services. And that needs to change. It hasn't always been that way, and it's not necessarily serving people in California well. In my community last night, two-thirds of the people voted for a parcel tax of $200, an emergency tax for the schools. Other communities in Yolo County, Woodland, for example, voted for a general tax, not last night, for to build a senior citizen center. This is in the middle of terrible economic situation and climate. We know that local communities know their needs, and when they are convinced of the benefits of those needs, they come forward and are willing to be taxed. I think we need to go in that direction more and more. We see with parcel taxes, we see with sales taxes for transportation, other uses. We see franchise fees, utility users taxes, hotel fees, and taxes. There are a number that exist now that have been supported in communities enthusiastically and grabbed onto as, in a sense, a lifeline for the kinds of services that we no longer provide or are willing to provide as a state. So I congratulate you for opening the discussion. Discussion on taxes is never easy, especially in this kind of era, but it's essential. And you started off by talking about restructuring and how, frankly, that underlying philosophy, which is actually a philosophy that Senator Huff and others should support, the notion of restructuring and giving authority and power and fiscal control back to the locals, where it, frankly, it really does belong ultimately. So congratulations. We will have a vote. Please.
Thank you, if I may, Madam Chair and members. I appreciate the thorough discussion and appreciate the worthy adversaries here, the witnesses, Senator LaMalfa, and especially Senator Huff, who always articulates his position very well. You talked about philosophy, and I agree with you, Madam Chair, that philosophy can sometimes get contorted because, frankly, inconsistent. You don't want the state to address these issues, but one of the philosophical underpinnings of the Republican philosophy, as I've always understood it, is local control. And again, in answer to Senator LaMalfa's question, at least the way I understood it initially, this doesn't change the two-thirds majority vote threshold at the local level to pass a tax. But one of the other philosophical underpinnings, I think, of Senator Huff's position is this issue of jobs and that we really need to get at California being a better job creator, and I agree. But the news isn't all bad, and we can talk about studies from yesterday, last year, 2 years ago, but I want to just, if I might, briefly quote today's piece in Dan Weintraub's article on the healthycal.org website. He writes, investors, meanwhile, don't seem to have lost confidence in California's dynamic entrepreneurial culture. The state led a national resurgence in venture capital investments in the first quarter of 2011. According to Dow Jones Venture Source, which tracks investment in startups, 40% of venture capital investments nationwide between January and March went to California companies. The state's firms recorded 262 deals during that period. The state with the next largest number, Massachusetts, had just 75. Let me get back to the bill, if I might, for a moment. We do have some philosophical disagreement, although I think that there's more that binds us than divides us. But again, on this bill, in opposing this bill, in my view, the philosophy you espouse would preclude local voters, local communities, from defining their own destinies with the same voter threshold that exists under Prop 13 and 218. And I would ask this fundamental question as we grapple with these great challenges we face as a state. Are we at a point where minority rule results in no viable way for representative government or the people to decide that they want